Hello and welcome to the Habit Coach Podcast. I am Arvind, Doctor, your Habit Coach. And today for a second time, we have Chaitanya with us, lawyer turned life coach. And what's interesting is that if you haven't heard the last episode, it was so interesting to understand his journey from switching careers. Now, today we're going to talk about his favorite ways on learning to coach yourself. So I find this an interesting topic. So I said, we definitely speak about this. So Chaitanya, welcome to the Habit Coach Podcast again.
Thank you, Ashton. Thank you.
So Chaitanya, can you actually coach yourself? Like, how do you start thinking about that?
Ideally, well, a coach is someone who kind of is a dissociated person. So it's ideally most if somebody else is doing it, but there are, of course, some learnings that you can pick up from the art of coaching and apply it to yourself, because it's effectively a good way to question some ways of thinking. And whatever gets you thinking about how you're thinking is a good way to self-coach. So, yeah, possibly.
So it starts by thinking, right? And anything that cues you into it.
Absolutely. So, of course, there are some steps and there are some quick takeaway steps that I can share with, but everything basically starts from thinking. And it's about not just floating in an inertia of thought, and it's about deliberately taking charge of how you're thinking. So for everything, thinking basically awareness. So for everything, put a spotlight how you're thinking, why you're thinking like that, question your thoughts, bring in more awareness, understand who you are, how you think, why you like that, and heighten your sense of your self-awareness. That's step number one. Second step would always be understand what lies beneath that awareness. Okay. Try and understand what those thoughts are really telling you. All right. Now, if I say I want to be successful, right? That's something that my thoughts throw at me. But what it's really telling me could be I want to make more money. Now there is a deeper level to that explanation. So that awareness now gets deepened. Once you figure out this is what I really want, then define what is success for me. Could be a small goal, could be your life, could be how you run your relationships, could be how you at work. What is your success criteria, right? Because you know what you really want. What does that translate into for success? That's step number three. Step number four is now you have your success criteria. Backtrack a plan of action to get there. Now you have your finish line. Figure out a plan timeline-wise where you know these are the steps I need to do, or these are the steps I think I need to do to get to that finish line. That's step number five. Fifth one would be, at this point, your mind will throw practical problems at you. You know what? This is difficult. This can't happen. So challenge those limiting beliefs. The more you question limiting beliefs about yourself, about things that are coming up as challenges, because our brain works, our amygdala will kick in and tell us, no, let's be safe. You know how evolution has made our amygdala. So its job, its upbringing is to protect us. Now the dangers are not as much as a lion eating us. It's more of us feeling the fear of failure. You know, so it's not life and death. But our brain acts in a way where it says, if we're moving away from safety, it is life and death. So therefore, we fear so much. Understand that this is not going to kill you. And that's how you start changing your limiting beliefs. You ask yourself, what's the worst that can happen if I do this? And when you understand that the worst is also showing you alive and well at the end of it, you realize it's probably an anticipated problem much more than an actual problem. That's fine. And the next step would be, think about this in this scenario. If you knew that your success is guaranteed, whatever your goal is, what is it that you would differently than what you're doing now? Now that suddenly takes care of that. What if it keeps that aside, it parks that problem. Now you, okay, it's coming to me. Now what will I do different? Suddenly now you're focusing on the action that you need to do, right? Now that basically helps in a few more neurons and more neural pathways in your brain about, oh, there's another reality that can actually work for me. Because you plug out that uncertainty from your head now, even for a moment. And now you've shown your brain this new reality that, oh, I can get there. Now it's getting excited. And the seventh step would be, if nothing works, fast forward to the to the last day, it's a little morbid, but last day on your deathbed and yourself, what would be a greater regret? Would it be taking this and failing or not trying this at all? Often than not, depending on the goal, it will be, the bigger regret would be maybe not trying this at all. And so that will also probably push you a little forward towards, let's try it, what the hell? Yeah. I think those six or seven steps come really handy in self-coaching.
Interesting. So let's break down each of these steps, okay? Because you've told us all six, seven. Let us break it down. So the first one is thinking. Now, tell us what, according to you, is the best way of thinking. Should you be thinking as in looking at this thing? Should you be thinking with a pen and paper? Should you be writing down your thoughts? Should you be recording your thoughts? What is the best way of getting into a state of thinking?
It works differently for different people. There are people who are auditory by nature. There are people who are kinesthetic by nature. There are people who are visual by nature. If just as a quick tip, in a coaching session, if you start, if I'm coaching you perhaps, and if you start saying stuff like, you know, I see myself doing AB and, you know, sometimes I can't picture myself. Now, in the two statements, you use the word see and picture. It's given me a cue that you're a visual person, right? Now, for you, it'll help if you write in which you can see. For you, that will be a stronger registering, right?
Interesting.
For somebody who's an auditory person who will say, I love when people tell me that you are a... Now, that person will connect stronger. You record who they are, what they think about themselves, and listen to it. And the kinesthetic kind would say, I want to feel empowered. I want to feel, I need to get the emotion of, it's a feeling-based thing. That person can speak with someone and get a sense of what that connection is giving them. So it's different things for different people. With different effectiveness. So most of the people are actually a combination. Nobody is only one thing.
Correct.
Firstly, so you figure out what works for you better. Writing, journaling works for a lot of people. Because journaling does is, even as you're writing, you're thinking. So that also is in your kinesthetic. As you think, if you're not sure, if you're an auditory, read it out loud as well. So you're covering all three. So the great way to bring in all your senses and just start think more actively.
Think, write, read. Correct? That brings everything.
Read aloud. Together. Read aloud.
Superb. Read aloud. Read aloud. Correct. And that brings everything together. So that's a fantastic style of thinking. Very, very good. The second step was?
What lies beneath? So now
what lies beneath?
What lies beneath under that awareness? So, now, if what I thought, wrote, and read aloud, I want to get financial freedom, right? Now, if that's a thought that I wrote, the question is, okay, a simple, simple cheat code here could be, ask yourself why two or three times in, you know, to every answer. Okay, I want to have financial freedom. Why? Well, I want to have independence. Why? Well, that makes me feel that I was, why? Well, it make my family proud. Now you keep going deeper. We'll keep going deeper. It'll make my family feel proud. Why? Because I feel I've let them down. Why? I got acknowledgement from my family. Why? Because I didn't do my best. And suddenly you'll be like, damn, I've gone so deep in just whys, right? Why, how, what, where, when? I mean, it's just a magic, you know, what these questions can do. So the more you ask yourself these questions, the more it will take you down to your core about why that awareness is symptomatically telling you what I want, right? But the condition is something else.
Yes.
So the symptom is I want to, and think today, I want to get financial freedom. But the condition is I want validation, for example, right? So that brings you to the real issue when you come to what it's really telling. So that's step two. So you question that awareness over and over, over and over, over and over till it trickles down to the real issue. That's step two.
So in fact, in and the Habit Coach podcast as well, we talk about this, that don't create a habit until you figure out your intention for it. And this against with asking your three whys. Right? Why do you want to do it? If you want to go for it in the morning, don't just go for a run because your neighbor started going for a run. That's the least strong why that you can possibly think of. Right? Unless you have like a major crush on your neighbor and stuff like that, then that's pretty good for going. But ask yourself, why do you want to go for a run? I want to go for a run because I want to get fitter. All right, why do you want to get fitter? And you'll come down to a very deep personal issue or personal need. Then use that.
Yeah.
Sometimes you might not come down to something deep and that you realize was just something that you wanted to do, but not necessarily something that has an intention. Correct? Why do you want to eat Thai food?
Sure. Yeah,
I want to eat Thai food because then fades away. So there's not a deep intention for that. So it's interesting. Start doing your why. Something will be deep. Some things might not.
Superb. Absolutely. Absolutely. Very well put. Yeah.
What is the third step?
Third step is, what is success criteria? Now, we'll just take this example forward since we've started with this. So financial freedom comes down to say, I want validation. Now, what makes me feel that, this is the finish line that happened. Now, therefore, I'm feeling validated. So in my head, I'm like, I can think success for me in this aspect, for me getting validation, could be my parents telling me, wow, we're so proud of you. Right, that could be the third step. So that I know that there is it's not a vague feeling, it's a tangible, it's a tangible line. Like I know I'll cross this line when somebody will tell me that, right? So you define that success criteria more clearly now. That's the third step.
So is this normally a success criteria in terms of people who are connecting with you, like, for example, make parents proud? Or is it a number thing, like have 200,000 downloads by so-and-so type? Like, what way is...
Could be anything.
So it can be a number goal.
Could
it
be
can
anything be as long as it's specific.
So make it a
specific goal. As long as it's specific. The idea here is to realize, I'm coming close to it or I've reached. If you keep saying, I want to get validation, but you don't know when that comes for you. You don't know what track to run on. You know, it's like saying, I want to run a marathon, right? 10 people say, I want to run a marathon. Everyone's like, yeah, let's marathon. Now, in someone's head, the marathon is 1 mile long. In someone's head, it's 3 miles long. Everyone's running their own race.
Correct.
Everyone thinking they've won the marathon, right? So that line has to be defined that, this is, I know I have achieved the goal. Could be numbers, could be emotional, whatever, could be anything. But as long as you know, this is what I'm aiming for.
Nice. So that's identify your parameter for success and put a number target or a specific target to it. Lovely. So that was step three. Step four.
Simple plan. Now you know, this is my success criteria. Now you know, my parents giving me validation is the success criteria for me to get financial independence. What means proud? Now that's the success criteria you start. So I need to get there. What is it? What actions that I can do which are in my control, which can get me to that success criteria? And now you start backtracking from that place. And you get smaller micro goals to level up to that final goal. So that's the action plan that you make.
But like Chaitanya, like this is the hardest part for most people. They can do the thing bit, but the action part is the hardest. Do you have a tips or tricks on how to actually get down to the action mode?
I think it starts from a place of firstly understanding. See, it's a... There may not be a straight jacket formula here, but a lot of things come down to consistency. And a lot of people have that motivation to follow through on a motivation in the beginning, but then it kind of fizzles out. It comes down to how bad you want it. And if you're able to build consistency on it, people write so much on willpower, it's unfair on willpower. I think you need to, and you'll know the space best. It's a habit that you build. Consistency is a habit. It's like building stamina. You're not born with it. You may be born with a drive, but you build consistency like you build stamina. So people who get to know that, this is my success criteria, also need to figure out the habits that they need to tweak or bring in along the way to reach that, right? Now, in my head, if I want, say, financial independence in this example, I need to also figure out, I need to get educated on finances. I want to start saving better. I want to see how other people invest their needs, somebody who, say, maybe a role model for me has, you know, done that thing in their own life. I will build habits around that, an ecosystem which basically makes things more foolproof for me, right? Those are the action plans which basically create framework for you so that you can just walk those steps. Those habits and those consistencies come down to the quick takeaway here could be start very, very micro. Start very, very micro, but do it consistently. So people who want to start exercising and they say, you know, I find it overwhelming. I cut out 1 hour a day, take out 10 minutes a day, walk for 10 minutes, take that day off as exercise done. But do that 10 minutes for 10 days. Throw out the intensity, do that minutes, get into the habit of doing the activity rather than intensity. Once you get the consistency in place, intensity can be then 12 minutes, 15 minutes. That's the easiest thing then. But people will go 1.5 hour crazy and they'll be like, next 4 days, DOMS. Zero X. And then they fear. Then fear and pain is associated with exercise.
Correct.
The willpower goes out of the window.
Yeah, absolutely. And listeners of the Happy Coach podcast will love you for this, because it's all about understanding the small, small actions that you can start putting into your day. And it doesn't matter whether they're huge and they're worthy actions. And, you know, that's the trap that we fall into. And I'm like, if it's not big, there's no point doing it. Cool idea, start small, because just starting itself is such a pain. You know, the inertia of just starting. So start small, start making those tiny, tiny changes. And you'll see that develop, that compound over time, grow over time. Lovely. All right, step five.
I use the example of... Sorry, I just want to add one more thing. Use the example you can build a house in 2 days, with wooden panels and all those things. Or you can build a mansion with bricks. That'll take longer. What do you think is more sturdy in a storm? And, you know, the one that took longer to build. Why? Because the platform is just stronger. The foundation is stronger.
Correct.
Now, you want to build a bricks in 2 days, not going to happen. Or it'll be a very small house.
Yeah.
So you need to figure out. So that's the clarity on what is success criteria helps you.
Correct. Allow time to happen. Allow for time. I think time is the best growth catalyst that's there on your side. Completely ignore it. We're so anti-time right now. Everything has to be fast. All right. Lovely. So, Chaitanya, five.
Fifth step is challenge your limiting beliefs. Now, at this stage, your mind will tell you, you know, it's possible to make everyone happy. You know, what is money? You know, I can't make that much money. That person had a head start. That person, you know, he has a background where, you know, finances are this, that. Everything will be thrown at you. Your brain testing you about how badly do you really want it. And if you do really want it, this is the time you stand up, you know, to it. And this eternal battle, because this is where a lot of people tap out that, yeah, you're right, you know, actually. Or some people will take, let's just take a few steps and see. And as you keep doing that, you realize that there is almost this magical power in focus on action rather than the consequence. So when you just start taking micro actions, it starts beating down this negative mindset of yours, which is just showing you failure. Something literally chemically starts changing. We start finding joy in the journey. And honestly, that's where the magic is. People who've made great bodies will always reminisce about the struggle much more than the day when they took the six-pack photo. It's because the struggle is where the magic was, that the pain, the love for that struggle, the sacrifices is where the true emotional depth is touched. So that's the same thing. So your brain will show you all the reasons to be safe, to not go into charter territories which have not been chartered by you. Stay in your comfort zone, because that's literally what our evolution has for brain to do. That's its job, and it's doing it well. But in today's time, we are not in an environment where we will be eaten by a lion at night if we, you know, so we don't need that kind of stress. That's when you start questioning, what's the worst that can happen? That's the worst. I can handle that. And then your brain's like, you can handle that. You're like, yeah, that's fine. In fact, I would love for that to happen. It'll teach me 5 extra things. The brain suddenly unarmed. Damn, what do I throw at this person? You keep challenging those limiting beliefs, and you will over time loving the pain that comes with that growth.
Lovely. How would you define a limiting belief?
Anything that would, you know, make you feel, give you second thoughts about it.
Okay. Anything that would limit you. Anything that is holding you back, limiting you, making you second guess yourself, second thoughts about, is this the right way? Is it this? Should it be like this? So anything that, like you said, is disempowering, removing the power that you have.
Absolutely.
Lovely. And anything
that, that is magnified derails you from the process would be limiting belief. Anything that pushes you further on the track would be a positive belief.
Is there a place for limiting beliefs? As in, like, you know, is it an early warning system from people? Do some people who don't have a limiting belief, do they end up completely, you know, going off the rails as well? Is there a balance between the two, or like a
limiting belief? You have to find your balance.
Negative primarily.
Yeah. I mean, it's a good mechanism. It's a mechanism that shows us risk. Like, it shows us these are the risks. Okay. Now it's like an insurance company saying, okay, these are the things I'll cover you with. I'm not covering. So then you will be like, okay, fire insurance I don't have. So let's be careful about bringing in the gas cylinder. That's the layout of the land. Now you have that. It will show you the red flags. Now, know these are the red flags. For some people who are just adrenaline junkies and who are just crazy for that that spark, that zest, they be bothered less. They'll be like, eh, so what? You know, I tasted that blood and I love it. And for some, for whom stability, security matters a lot, that there's a system of value hierarchies that one can do in a coaching session. So you understand that, okay, for me, freedom matters a lot. And therefore, taking risk is something that's well with my core value system. And for somebody, for me, comfort and stability is the most, and therefore risk taking is something I'm very averse to, right? It differs for people. It differs for people. And accordingly, the frequency and the intensity of the alarm rings will also be different. Now, if you, a person like you, who's already made a transition into this successfully, if you are to start a new venture, your alarm bells would be much more dimmer than first time around, because you've done it once. There is a history of a proven success path, right? If you do it the third time around, it'll pretty much not exist. You'll just find it exciting. So it's different for different people.
Very nicely put. So the limiting beliefs are, if there are red flags that you acknowledge and say, all right, I've understood, chalega, let me try. Perfect. If it's a limiting, if those red flags to limiting beliefs saying mujhse na ho payega, I will not be able to do this only, that's when it is disempowering. Super. Yeah. And you mentioned two very nice statements to ask yourself, right? One was, what is the worst that can happen? And the second was, if there was no chance of failing, what would I be doing? Correct? Those are the two.
Yeah, that's actually the next step. Yeah.
So if success
was guaranteed to you. No, you're right there. That's the next step. If success in this goal, whatever your goal is guaranteed, right? If suddenly you're transported into the future and you see, oh, I'm getting this. I've already got this. Now you know you're getting it. What is it now that changes in your conduct today? Suddenly, because see, we're all people who are averse to taking risks. You know, they're treading a careful path because they don't want to fall off a track which seems comfortable, right? Because somewhere they've earned a track which gets them that comfort now to kind of gamble it away. So they're treading carefully. Now, if you suddenly show them, actually, this is the highlight reel, you've already reached there, and then the person will start walking quicker. Oh, great. I'll just. Suddenly the mindset now shifts from walking carefully to, oh, I can get there quicker, right? Now, if you ask your brain questions like, why do I hate myself? If you ask yourself that, your brain will be like, let's go to the mental library and look for why do I hate myself, okay? If you ask yourself, why do I love myself? Your brain will be like, why do I love myself? Let's go to the library. It'll answer what you ask it. Now, if you're showing it, there is a guaranteed success. It'll show you the path to get there. But if you're only showing it, the problem come on the way, it'll just highlight that. Be careful there also. It's just following your orders.
Beautiful. This is actually one of the most empowering exercises that you can do, right? If your success was guaranteed, what would you be doing? And like, you're just completely changing the structure of the words in your mind. You know, you're not thinking about any negativity. You're not thinking about any, oh my God, but if only, like you said, if only, those kinds of questions don't come up anymore. Because now you're focusing on the end goal and you visualize it and you're like, wow, you're excited about it. And it's that excitement, that energy that you bring to your day and to bring to whatever you're doing. And, you know, guys, what Chaitanya has put out across in these six steps is so, so powerful. Just start doing it at home and seeing what a difference it starts making, right? Chaitanya said, it all starts with thinking, figuring out what is going on in the head of yours. You know, it's so strange that our minds, our brains are one of the most powerful tools that we have. And we don't use it at all. In fact, we let it control us. Instead of that, start using it, learning how to think, learning how to be with yourself, learning how to be with your thoughts. It completely changes the game. And then use the steps that Chaitanya has outlined, because these are steps that you can actually take towards bringing that change about in your life. So Chaitanya, I think it was fantastic sharing those six steps. Any other thoughts that you have on this coaching thing? Anything that you want to tell people about how to either do coaching or why they should reach out to you or to a life coach? What is that journey like for people?
It's a very fascinating journey to observe from the place of a coach, right? And people who are in the chair of a coachee or the client are going through a transformation, and it's almost like you see that happening physiologically, right? In sessions, as things progress, you start seeing that they start thinking differently, telling you their problems differently without realizing that they're thinking differently. And because, you know, you're trained professionally to observe those things, it's really fascinating, and it's really you find it very impressive, and you want to applaud the client for doing that. And so it's very fascinating and rewarding from the coach's chair. But from a coach's chair, something that certainly has a shift in their life, you know, brings a shift in their life. It becomes a defining moment. That phase becomes a different moment, because, you know, I genuinely believe, you know, jagro tabhi savera. So whenever you want to take the reins in life, it's never too late. You just follow what you feel is right for you. A coach will help you get there because he's not attached sensitively to your goal. That guy's a professional skilled in this space who co-create a plan of action with you to get there faster, more efficiently, probably save you a decade in time and resources. And this is an investment that people need to start seeing it as, you know, which is why the maximum number of people who come, you know, to coach for coaching are high achievers and just high performers. They are people who understand what the art of coaching can get them. It's like someone in the gym and your dumbbells are there. You can pick them up. You can do your cardio machine. But you hire a personal trainer, suddenly your accountability becomes better. Your form is being noticed. There are some technicalities that the person's pointing out. There is a certain level of motivation that comes with it. Everything around you about how, whether you want to drag your feet, my accountability don't feel like going to today, but if I don't go, the person might just cut money for the class. Everything creates an ecosystem around that person where after a year or a few months, there is a genuine physical transformation and a mental transformation, right? Mm. Now, translate that to your entire life. You will be changed as a person. Some people come and want to be more communicative in a relationship. You get down to why they're not doing that. And it's not like therapy. It's not like I'm going to your childhood and trying to source a pain point and saying, how was your relationship with your parents? So I'm acknowledging where you are today. Whatever got you there, fair enough. Mm. How do you want to get to the future?
Interesting.
How do you want to get there? Let's work on that. Mm. Forget what happened. If you want to do therapy parallelly, go for it. Mm. Right? But if you're really driven to get to a future which is truly inspiring and exciting for you, hire a life coach.
Right.
Hire a life coach. There is no side effect that comes with it. Mm. There is nothing that is messing you up. Mm. It's a very simple process where trust is established first, rapport is built, and it's a lot of give and take. And it's a beautiful relationship which just helps a person bloom. And I think it's one of the most rewarding things that somebody can do for themselves.
Lovely. Superb. Thank you so much, Chaitanya, for sharing these with us, sharing these steps with us, and the journey that somebody can be on. How can people get in touch with you to find out more?
Any of my social media channels. So on Insta, you can find me at cpuri, C-P-R-I. On Facebook, my page, Chaitanya Puri, is a quick to get in touch. Twitter, it's _ Chaitanya Puri. LinkedIn, just Chaitanya Puri. All my media handles would also have my phone number on it. Text me, WhatsApp me, we'll fix up a call if you want. I do a 15-minute discovery call before any session as well, and we can judge if our synergies and our if there's a good connection. I take the client.
Super. Yeah,
so that would be a good way to.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming onto the podcast and sharing this.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashton. Thank you so much for your time. A lovely, lovely experience.
My pleasure.
If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on the IVM podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on social media. We are at IVM Podcasts on Twitter and Instagram. If you want to reach out to me, I am Ashton Doc on Twitter and Instagram. You can find lots more information on my website, awesome180.com, or check out different content on my YouTube channel called AWESOME180. That's Awesome180.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. So it's been a great week on the network, as it almost always is. Let me give you a couple of highlights that you should definitely check out. Chiki Sarkar was on This Rounds on Me with Gauri Devidayal. Great conversation. Think you will really enjoy that. Shlok Ramachandran of our new show, Millennial Athlete, who guested on one of our older shows, Football Shirtball. He's a big football fan, in addition to being a professional athlete. So I think it's a really interesting connection. And they had a great conversation about football just generally. Nankari, our new show about Indian food, hosted by Sadaf and Archit, talk about laddus this week and basically, how awesome they are. It's Diwali week, and I think that's an apt conversation for them to have. On the Wire Talks podcast, Siddharth Bhatia has a great conversation with Dylan Mohan Gray about his work on Bad Boy Billionaire, specifically around the Vijay Mallya episode. Definitely check out the conversation if you want to know more about that. And finally, let me recommend the Edges and Sledges Cricket podcast this week. They take a look back at the IPL 2020. They go over the final, Delhi versus Mumbai, and how that played out. And they also create their dream IPL 2020 fantasy team. Do check that out. I think you'll enjoy that as well. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Hi guys, this is Ayushi.
And I am Ritasha.
And welcome to Agla Station Adulthood, It's a fun podcast we've got going on, and we'd love for you to tune in and enjoy with us.
Join us as we stop at various stations and discuss different topics that seem to be bothering us, and hopefully
dating,
you as
relationships,
well.
Relationships, beauty, just being an adult, lots of different things.
We don't have a great grip on it, but we've done okay so far.
Catch Agla Station Adulthood every Thursday on the IVM app, the IVM website, or wherever else you get your podcasts.